focus your feelings and emotions. Feelings of sadness enters the hearts of those in the universe. The Cegians, losing their ability to focus on this society. The death and destruction and the evil is coming quick. The rise of vice soon overpowers the great power of the Fendu. Awakening in a land of sadness, frustration and heartache was everywhere. The Predator was smiling in the shadow as he attacked earlier was fine. Now in the free light, he smiles while the great star shining at him. He strikes nothing in shadow, but in the present. The evil power he possesses, he listens only to himself. Some leap over the obstacles that stop them, over and over, waiting for the evil to die and pass away. But nothing of that sort happens. Citizens of all systems watch and see the powerful Predator rise as king with new power. The Shadon Empire is a new power. The new empire was evil. The leader of this is the evil sovereign. The malice is nowhere. The leader of the Vartals is dead. Or are they? Great battle stations were getting built in every system on almost every planet. These were weapons that were a great threat to the last remains of the great commonwealth of the Galactic Forum. These weapons were on the system of Jolopel. The Vartal has great power in this great society. Slavery was all over the city. It was pain and suffering. Men of all species were carrying heavy machinery. The building of the battle stations weren't like other planets in the universe. This was once a society, part of the extended territory. This was a city under the rule of the Mendons. Now the leader of the Mendons and the sovereign of this Shadon Empire has great power. They were in a secret partnership. The true power in this was the sovereign. His powers were great in comparison to his enemies. His enemies were the only powers that would be able to stand in his way. The slavery of this planet was odd, especially for the past history of the Mendons. In the past, the leaders of the Mendons would be against this, but since the new leader was under the control of the sovereign, he ignored his species history. Jolopef was the leading planet in the old extended territory. The old leaders would be against this 100%. Because of the influence of the sovereign, the Mendon's leader would put a small portion of the planet in slavery. The sovereign's plan was to cover the entire planet. The only problem was the Mendon's colleagues. They stood in their way. The sovereign and the Mendon were planning on controlling all. They were planning to control the last remains of the great galactic form. In the large city, Brunoland, humans and aliens were all over. They were serfs. The serfs here were building. This was so odd. And all other systems used edifice matan to construct buildings. The serfs were men. Most of them used primitive tools, tools from the first 4,000 years of the universe. Brunoland was a semi-sand covered land. It was hot. The great fire star, the star that destroyed Equate's twin, two millenniums ago, beamed down on the serf men. The serfs didn't stop with men. Serfs were females, teens, and children. Children ranged in all ages, especially young boys. On the corner of the sand field, there was Kato Asu Rambler and Khan Ipe. The two of these were friends. They were truly like siblings. They lived on this planet for many years. These two were serfs. They were in the section of the semi-factory chain line that was supposed to build the power records of the Shadon Empire, culmination battle station. They were standing with a fat bearded man. He was carrying the generators for the records turning sequence. They were standing in a line. The line was long and curvy. They were standing with a woman and her two children. there was a Kivian female. She was also carrying metallic crates. These crates were holding the missile Reco bolt cartridges for the Recos. There was a lot of children. These children were of all ages. They were of many different species. They were standing in a line with many different parts for the battle station. Every being, once they were in front of the line, they connected their portion to the battle station. While they were standing in the line, many Melimatons were walking on their side. They were walking back and forth. They were doing this to keep everything in line. Kato and Khan were there. Kato and Khan were carrying culmination battle records. The Reco was a modern version of the firearm. This was a device that fired energy bolts. The bolts were very powerful. They were nothing like the bullets from the firearms of Earth, but they were fired from a Reco. But when they were fired from a Reco, they are far more dangerous than a bullet from a gun. The Reco bolts were stored in cartridges. The cartridges were connected to the back of the Reco. There were many different types of Recos. They vary in size of cartridges, number of rounds, and of course, colors. Most of the young serfs were quiet and obedient. Kato then began to speak. He was very quiet in the process. He spoke in a manner so none of the Melimatons would hear him. "Man, this is heavy. I can't believe it is like that. I hate those Mendons. I wonder why Gyro is doing this." "I know what you mean," said Khan. "This culmination battle record is heavy. They have all these Matons walking around securing this, making sure we don't escape. Ha! We don't have to escape. They're just going to shoot us anyway." "Man, I'd love to." One Maton then walked toward them. His senses picked up their conversation. He interrupted his modern, Matonic synthesized voice. "Humans, stop talking." Khan and Kato were very quiet. Mela Matons then walked away. Khan was very rebellious. But when he was the only one, he stood there. He was only of the age of 9, the same as his comrade next to him. Condon said silently, "I'd love to use this on one of those batons and scimitars. If they only gave me 1 second to get in control of this Reco, I would destroy every baton, the soldier in my sight. I would even destroy Gyro." "You would do what?" said Kato. "I hate him too, but I don't want to kill anyone." "I can't believe you said that." "Yeah, I said it," said Khan. "This is brutal, lads. Gyro has his place covered with scimitars and batons. I wouldn't do it." "But if you did, how would you do it?" said Kato with a very intrigued look on his face. Khan said silently, "Well, first, I would finally creep around the wall, shoot every Matan in sight. I would then steal one of the Scimitar's paces and go to Gyro's castle. I would destroy him. Last, I would destroy every person who is evil and has power in the galaxy." "Well, do you think it's possible to destroy them?" said Kato quietly. "You know, your problem? What do you mean?" "The voices. Do you still hear them?" "Yes, they keep talking to me. They're trying to tell me what to do. They tell me to finish my destiny. I'm so confused." Kato said, "Do you believe you can still destroy?" Khan thinks to himself. He wasn't looking at Kato anymore. Then he finished. When Kato finished, "Do you believe you can destroy Gyro?" "Yeah, I'm positive," said Khan. "I would destroy him." And Khan stared and started to speak as if he carried bitterness. "I would destroy him nice and slowly. I would pay them back for killing my father. I would use Star Raker to strike everyone in the chest as he did to my father 4 years ago. Then, he can't destroy me anymore. Every single one of them. As he found Sophie, he thought all of it. He was thinking about his mother's voice calling. He heard it again in his head. He was thinking about his father's cries while struggling for his life. He heard the sadness of the people that were in his neighbors. He was thinking about his early life. While he was thinking, Kato was speaking about something. Two Matons from across the sandfield floated on their foot rocket boosters. They flew towards the two 9-year-old boys in the battle station line. They spoke at the same time. Humans, freeze! Then the first Maton that spoke earlier came towards the two young serfs in line. Now there were three Matons around the serfs. The first Maton that spoke to them earlier said, I thought I told you no talking. Listen, we made you, said Todd. He continued to speak, but this time he was speaking to them as if they were programmed with a natural defection. He was speaking in a very slow manner. He was also moving each finger up and down. One finger up and one finger down, very slowly. Every syllable he spoke, a finger moved down and up. You are a stupid Maton. We think for ourselves. They think for you. You have to be punished. Come, we deliver you to Giro. You will be punished for breaking rules of our battalion. You will let our master deal with you, said another Maton. After the Maton said that, Kato fought greatly. He remembered reading some data boards about what happens when put before Giro. He remembered reading they would be sent to death. Kato then came back into realization when one of the Matons grabbed his wrist tightly and put Shaddai in electric cuffs. The cuffs were very tight. Then as a gigantic vehicle flew down, there was a shimmy from pod stage carrier, and the vehicle lowered two more ships forward. They were filled with all the other criminally charged refugees and put in a shimmy from pod stage carrier with other rebels to be put before Giro. Then many soldiers surrounded the citizens and chased the citizens and killed some of them. Sounds of people screaming in fear was heard very loudly. Cuffs were placed on many citizens. The Matons were breaking in the dominant. The Matons were yanking through a middle-aged human woman carrying children. A young human man about the same age as Todd and Kato. There was also 3 Fallopians and 2 Calvarians. All of these beings were approached by the male Matons. These Matons had cuffs. They were approaching the rebellious beings with the cuffs to grab the wrist of these beings. Get the hell off me, said one of the rebellious adult males. Help, leave me alone, said the woman with the infant. She sounded a bit pitiful. We didn't do anything. Please leave me alone. My name is Jacobet. I am a very peaceful person. I don't cause any trouble. Please leave us alone. We'll be good. Please let me keep my children. The Matons then reached for the children. Please let my child go, please. She is innocent. She knows not what is happening. Then the sound of a child being yanked from its mother began. It was crying. Finna get your hands off me. I'll beat your ass, said the young man. Human, shut your mouth, said a Maton. The boy started mumbling, saying, my name is Theophilus Phillips. I'd like to see you make me shut it. What? Said the Maton with seriousness. Nothing, said the young human male with an attitude. The Maton then handed the infant back to him. The power of the cry interrupted the frequency of the machine warrior. When the Maton turned around, the boy then saw a wire hanging there from his Tentacom power box on his back. He then pulled the wire, and the Maton then exploded into thousands of pieces. Quickly, 15 Simultrals surrounded him with weapons in each of their hands. One of them shot him in the back of the neck and made him drop and fall on the ground. The Matons then put all the rebels in chains or cuffs. They were then forced inside the carrier. The rebels then heard one of the Matans saying they were going to the city. A sound of fear went out among the citizens. Outside of the cage, Caracato heard a similar say to a male Matan, "Where are they going?" The other responded, "Giro's personal city, Diablo." "Good. Today is a special day for the citizens." The cruiser then rose from its resting spot. It was hovering in the air. It then turned around and went through the city of Brunoland and passed many domiciles, riding through the sand-filled city of Brunoland. It was 4 miles. They passed the buildings. They soon entered a semi-wooded area. The cruiser then rushed through the woods, knocking down trees, while on the carrier the rebels started to talk before their death. Khan and Kato were inside of the cage. They were on the opposite side. Jochebed was inside of the carrier with her 2 young infant children. They were a male and a female. There was the rebellious man, the young man who made a semi-explosion, a group of many different beings, and a being sitting in the corner with a hood covering his face in the corner. This being was quiet. He never spoke a word. Kato was extremely worried. He was somewhat scared if you looked at him. He didn't have a clue of what his next move was going to be. He was so nervous, he started to speak. "Hey, Khan, have you ever been to Diablo?" Khan was shocked. He wasn't going to speak. He was thinking about how he was going to escape his death. Kato distracted him from his meditation. Khan didn't want to be rude. He responded to his best friend, "No, I haven't been to Giro's personal city. I heard everyone who goes there never returns, or returns a member of the Shadan Empire." "Yeah, I've never met anyone who has been there. Not one."
Thank you for watching this segment. So please, if you like what you hear, tap the like button, and also, please subscribe so you can hear the continuing story of Shadows of War, Book the First, The Prophecy Continues. My name is Zay Harris, and thank you for joining me. I'm going to report. God bless.